Latif Psycho Spiritual Centers Part 2 Nafs. This Latifa is located slightly below the navel, and it is said it is yellow in color, while for others its location is between eyebrows and the color is blue. This is based on individual experiences because these are subtleties. The word nafs is usually translated as ego self or psyche. Its etymology is rooted in breath and is common to virtually all archaic psychologies where the act of breathing was connected with life, animating otherwise lifeless objects. In this respect, there are other ancient notions like prana in Hinduism and in other languages, Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. Some Sufis consider many things, many spiritual, psychological processes under nafs. They include whole mental, emotional, and other aspects of life. It is basically a lower emotion, egoistic and passionate human nature. Ego may be assumed as an equivalent for nafs in modern psychology. The Sufi masters emphasize that first of all, the mukamats are the stages of nafs, which is nafs has to be worked on, and then we work on the higher emotions, which comes under the category of suluk. Nafs comes under the category of jazb. Jazb means an intense state of emotions. Passion, lust, anger, greed, these are the aspects of heightened emotions or jazb. And Sufi Sheikh Brijmohan Lal and Sheikh Lalaji Razillah Ta'ala Unhu has said, along the path, the Sheikh has to work on jazb first and then work on the stages of suluk. Only then there is a possibility of proper growth, otherwise there are chances of deviation. There is an important story where Lalaji and his Sheikh Maulana Fazl Ahmad Khan Quddus Surrahu Raziyallahu Ta'ala Unhu used to live. He heard that there was a boy who has to be kept in chain. He was a grown-up young boy and he used to remain in cage chained because he could not control his emotions and used to run behind the human beings for fulfillment of his passion, and then when he could not get that, he used to run behind the animals. So when Sheikh Maulana Fazl Ahmad Khan Raziyallahu Ta'ala Unhu heard, he carried Lalaji Raziyallahu Ta'ala Unhu with him to the place, and two of them sat down and he told Lalaji that give the tawajjuh. This is a particular way of Sufi master. When they have to work on a particular lataif, they give tawajjuh from a different location. Normally the sheikhs allow the tawajjuh to come because it is combination of two things. First is command and the other is compassion. So the heart center and the center between the eyebrows, from there the tawajjuh has to be given and its light must fall on the nafs lataif of the seeker. And he told him that give tawajjuh from that lataif to this person. First day he became calm after the tawajjuh. Second day he was able to recognize the sheikh, and after third or fourth sitting he became normal. Then he mentioned his only fault was that he accepted an incomplete sheikh as his master and he was not able to provide the proper organized process of transformation. It is very important how we, it was to happen, but it is for us a learning process that how we have to take care of the seekers. If a strong energy force is sent, it can damage the seeker. So the energy force has to be in a small moderate doses so that it works at the same time, it does not harm seeker. As a medical profession, you will know when the doctor sees seriousness of the patient, he administers the doses accordingly. The present day situation is of the masters and the seekers is very intricate. It is the seeker who says who is seeking a master, a sheikh or guru. I have heard in America there was a big company. The owner was a very rich person. That was an automobile company. They were dealing in many brands of automobile. It happened that they were selling expensive brands, BMW, Toyota, Hyundai and other brands. And the responsibility was of the salesman to sell a particular brand. And they were not salaried people. They have to get the commission when they sell a particular brand of car, and that's how they will get their salary at the end of the month. So he observed that his sale is falling, and then these salesmen, instead of selling the products, they are constantly arguing among one another. When a particular customer comes, each one of the salesmen were trying to grab him. The person comes to buy a Toyota, then the Hyundai salesman will tell him the good qualities of the Hyundai and he condemns the Toyota model. The other highlights the qualities of BMW. So the consumers used to remain in quite conflict and they do not know which of the brand is suitable and which one they should buy or not. The sales was dropping. So one day the owner decided to have a meeting of all the salesmen and he told him that I am the owner of this company. All the brands are marketed by me. But then he got quietened when the salesman said, "Sir, you do not give us a fixed salary. We have to use our expertise to sell our product by highlighting their qualities. And then when we sell a particular vehicle, we get a fixed amount of commission on selling a vehicle. And that's how we make our living. We have our families to mind. So we cannot go at the end of the month without salary. Sometimes it happens if we do not sell a vehicle, we do not get the salary as commissions." The owner had no option. This is the situation of all our religious preachers, priests, imams, and Hindu priests. They are all the salesmen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or God or Paramatma or whatever you call them. They are selling their product. The more glamorous they are in their approach of selling their product, they will attract the customers. It has become a business like activities. We are not bothered about the leading or taking the seekers to spiritual development or transformation. Instead, all of them are concerned about marketing their product efficiently with more attractions, buy one get one free and all kind of business practices. This is the situation that we face today. You may laugh at it, but this is, when you look deeply into it, this is how it goes on. We do not bother about telling the correct thing. A Hindu priest says that our method is the best and foolproof. So says the Christian, so says the Mohammedan priest. Let us come to nafs or ego, another dimension. You may not have washed it. When you are feeling very empty within, you start eating too much. Also, when you are feeling very lonely, you start eating as well. When you are missing your beloved or lover, you start eating too much. You stuff yourself. You just want to have a feeling of fullness, but no food goes into your inner emptiness. It can only stuff your stomach. It is destructive to your body if you eat too much, and you will remain empty within in spite of the food that you are stuffing. I have heard a parable. This is an interchange between Sufi mystic Simar and a nobleman named Mulakab. It is preserved in oral transmission as a dialogue often staged by wandering dervishes. Mulakab asked, "Tell me something of your philosophy so that I may understand." The mystic replied, "You cannot understand unless you have experience." Mulakab further said, "I do not have to understand a cake to know whether it is bad. The mystic said, if you are looking at good fish and you think that it is a bad cake, you need to understand less and to understand it better more than you need anything else. The businessman Mulakal said, then why do you not abandon books and lecture if the experience is the necessity? The mystic said, because the outward is the conductor to the inward. Books will teach you something of the outward aspect of the inward, so will the lectures. Without them, you will make no progress in inward journey. Both are necessary. Mulakab then continued, but why should we not be able to do so without books? The mystic said, for the same reason that you cannot think without words. You have been reared on books. Your mind is so altered by books and lectures, by hearing and speaking, that the inward can only speak to you through the outward. Whatever you pretend, you can perceive. Man ultimately becomes what one pretends to be. Mulakal, does this apply to everyone? The mystic replied, it applies to whom it applies. It applies above all to those who think, it does not apply to them. This is an important dialogue. Sufism is alchemy. It is the science to transform lead into the gold, the baser into the higher, the outer into the inner. It is the science to transform the world into God. Remember, Sufism is not a philosophy. Instead, it is a science, and it is better to say all paths, they are the scientific approach, step by step, to move from lower to the higher. Sufism does not believe in speculations. It believes in experience. Instead of logical thinking, it believes in experimentation. Only experiment decides what is true. Remember, nothing else can be decisive. Only when you know, do you know. And there is no other way to know. Sufism does not trust in beliefs. If you want to drop all kind of beliefs, because they will be the barriers to knowing. A belief is a pseudo kind of knowing. You really do not know because you believe. Because you have believed so long, you start feeling as if you know. All your beliefs have to be taken away from you. You have to be left in ignorance and innocence. Remember, ignorance is the beginning of innocence. Only from there is the process of experimentation possible. Science presupposes nothing, no belief. There is no presupposition at all. Science starts with a blank mind. It proceeds with a hypothesis. All efforts are put for this hypothesis to be true or false. These are the three things you will have to understand deeply. The first is art. Art does not bother much about the object. It has its own projections. Art uses the object as a screen on which to project its subjectivity. When you see a woman's face or a child's face or a flower, art is not concerned with the objective. It is not concerned with all that is there. Art is concerned with what you make of it, all that you project onto it. Beauty is not part of the objective. Beauty is your dream. It is that you bring to the object, your emotions, your feelings that you bring to the object. It aims at making object look beautiful. Art invents. Art never discovers. It is not interested in discovery. It is inventive. It is imaginative. It is projective. This is the basic meaning of the word poet. The original root comes from potus, means one who creates. Art is creative. But what can you create? Whatsoever you create will be your mind projection. Art creates beauties. Look at the painting. The painter has a particular imagination and that he projects on the screen. Science is not creative in that sense. Science is discovery. Whatsoever is there, science only uncovers it. It does not invent. It has no idea to project. Science is objective. Art is subjective. With art, you have some projections, some ideas as a requirement. Before you come to the rose flower, you have come with some dreams in your mind. You have to nourish dreams. When those dreams are overflowing, they will overflow onto the rose flower. All your dreams will surround the rose flower with a glory and aura, and you will see something which is not there. You will see something which is really inside you and is only reflected from outside back to you. Art is a dream. Science is objective. The basic requirement of science is to go naked, to go without any prejudice, without any conditioning whatsoever. You go without any idea of what the case is, or maybe just to be there, impartial, objective, with no thoughts in the mind. It aims at watching whatsoever is there. Truth reveals itself if you can be a witness. That is the essence of the entire teaching of Buddha. Be a witness unto yourself. Science is pure witnessing, and then there is philosophy. Art at least projects onto something outside. Science does not project at all. It allows the outside to reveal its truth. And philosophy is pure subjectivity. It does not even bother about the screen. Art at least bothers about the screen. The screen has to be there, and then it can project. Philosophy is pure speculation. You close your eyes and you go into your thoughts, and you can go on and on forever. It is an endless procession of thought. Someone comes to you and wants to know what is New York like. What are the different places of visiting New York? You go to your room, go to your library, you pull out the map of New York, which have all the names and the images of the buildings, important monuments and places of visit. You show him all this. This is philosophy. You are not wrong. He asks you to show you various places of importance, tourist attraction in New York. You bring out a list. You show their images with the cards that are available. This is this, this is this, this is that. And you are finished. In no time, you have given him a complete tour of New York. This is philosophy. Philosophy is pure subjectivity. Science is pure objectivity. Art is just in the middle of the two. A little of philosophy and a little of science. A little of objectivity and a little of subjectivity. Art is a mixture of the two. Religion can be of three types. It can either be philosophical, or it can be artistic, or it can be scientific. Sufism is third kind of religion. Sufism believes in experiment. It does not believe in beliefs. It trusts only the truth that is already there. You have only to uncover it. This is the essence of Sufism.